Today, I'm going to interview a unicorn, an appealing but wholly imaginary creature, a person who has changed his sexual orientation from gay to straight. You and I have been told a million times that people are born gay. No one can change. Even trying to change is harmful. But logically speaking, even one man who changes his self-identification without lasting psychological damage is enough to disprove these sweeping assertions. At this point, the committed sexual revolutionary activists will respond in one of two ways. Number one, this man wasn't really gay to begin with. Or number two, he will surely backslide and revert to his true identity, which is, of course, gay. According to the sexual revolutionary narrative, my guest today doesn't really exist. Pastor Jim Domen was deeply involved in a gay lifestyle. He's an author, pastor, husband, and above all, a daddy. He's the founder of Church United and is passionate about the redemptive love of God and the recovery of men and women. Pastor Jim Domen, the unicorn, welcome to the Dr. J Show.
Hey, Dr. J, I have to tell you, if my youngest daughter, who's 5, would be on the show because she loves unicorns. But she knows her daddy is a real daddy, and I'm real, and I'm not a unicorn. Loved it. You know, it was fun. You're with this community that's saying, we'll welcome you. And I tell you, I really learned a lot because the LGBTQ community is very loving, opening, and welcoming to anybody. The weirdos, mm-hmm. the freaks, the geeks, the people with, you know, just people that don't fit into culture. You have a community that says, welcome, we love you. It's in its family. They call it your gay family. And moving into an environment like that. And Jenny, sin is fun. The devil's really good at, you know, just part truths, you know, just a little bit. And I thought, well, if I applied God's principles of marriage to my partner, and as Christians live, this is going to work. And, you know, it's not. And my partner was an alcoholic, addicted to marijuana. And I saw this for the first time. And I just was like, this is a life of living hell. On the outside, we were the happy couple. We owned an art gallery. We were successful. We made a lot of money. We lived like kings. And yet underneath it all is I was, you know, you're dying in. You know, my partner filed a restraining order with the Palm Springs.
So, which is it, Jim? Are you really gay? Were you ever really gay? And how long have you been married to a woman?
Well, great questions. Homosexuality is mutable. It's developmental, it's environmental, is the short answer. And I was in the gay lifestyle for 5 years. I've struggled with same-sex attraction the majority of my life. I've been married for, it'll be 15 years this June. And I tell you, what a contrast difference trying to make a same-sex relationship work is a living hell. And then being married to God's design and plan to my wife and having children, it's night versus day, good versus evil. It is a dramatic difference. And let me tell you something, it's the most rewarding and gratifying being selfless towards my spouse and family and children.
Well, that's a good short summary of your situation. I do want to hear more about your journey. My husband and I have celebrated 40 years of marriage, and you know, it draws something out of you to really be committed to another person. You have to grow in virtue, or you're not going to make it. You know what I mean?
It's absolutely like, it's like it's, and Dr. J,
I have to, part of the design. Part of God's design, I think, is that we grow up in our attraction to each other.
And I have to give you a shout out because last night when we were praying, I told my wife, I'm going to be on the Dr. J Show tomorrow. And she said, you know what? Wait, I remember her. I listened to an interview she did back in the days of Proposition 8 when the people of California changed our constitution, that Article 1, Section 7.5, that only a marriage between a man and a woman is valid or recognized. You did a talk on marriage, and it was so profound she remembered it. She said, Dr. J spoke about that marriage isn't for the husband and wife, it's for the children. And that you didn't use scripture and God, it was all logical, science-based, that it marriage is for children and it's the greatest opportunity for them to thrive. And I have to say, we're living that out and we see that even with divorce. And so I got to give you a shout out. That was a long time ago, Prop 8. And she remembered that talk you gave and she said it was excellent. I said, yes, I'm going to be on her show tomorrow. So well done. And thank you for your faithfulness of not only upholding scripture, but helping teach people why it's good.
Right. Well, thank you for that. I appreciate that you tell her I said that. Her name's Amanda, isn't that right?
Yes, it's Amanda.
Yeah, I don't think we had ever met. I think by the time you and I encountered each other in Prop 8, she either wasn't in the picture or just wasn't. I don't think I ever met her,
Yeah, I don't think you
but
met
we
her, but
do.
we were dating during Prop 8, and the night that it
Gotcha.
passed, I kissed her for the first time. So it was, yes, it was. She was very instrumental as we fought to keep
Yeah.
marriage between a man and a woman.
Well, I want to talk with you a little bit about Prop 8, but first of all, I would like you to give you the opportunity to tell the story of your personal journey from gay to straight. And in particular, I'm interested to know if therapy had any role in your process, because here at the Ruth Institute, we're quite concerned about the proposed bans on therapy. And I found in talking with a lot of different people who have made this journey in some way or another, that they're all over the place with what therapy, the significance of therapy and the kind of therapy and stuff like that. But I know our listeners are going to be really interested in that, Jim. What,
Yeah,
tell us your story.
so counseling choice is foundational. And I would accredit my ability to leave homosexuality and go into a straight heterosexual lifestyle was because I had proper, godly, biblically based counseling. And that was so instrumental in laying a foundation at the age of 16 to understand root causes of same-sex attraction. And be able to meet those childhood needs as an adult or young man, and then be able to work and process and understand what's going on at the environmental level, at the developmental level. And actually, kind of full circle, it's helped me become a better dad, Jenny. It really has. And, you know, there's nothing more heartwarming than, you know, my son wanted to become a pilot. I still think he does. Maybe a fireman or who knows what he wants to do now. But if you ask my oldest daughter, honey, what do you want to be? She says, I want to grow up and be a mommy. You ask my son, he goes, I want to grow up and be a daddy. That just is so foundational that they're seeing what mom and dad are pouring into them developmentally and teaching them that a boy's a boy, the boys protect the girls, and you know, and a girl is a girl, period. And so as we lay that foundation down, I don't believe they're going to struggle with the things I did as a little boy and then transitioning into puberty because we're addressing and connecting them with them developmentally of their sex and that God created them that way and it's good. But my story, yeah. So my story on the counseling side of things, why counseling choice is so important, and I'm going to throw this out there. There's a phrase called conversion therapy. Jenny, it doesn't exist. The left creates words and narratives to fit what they want to push, and they've been successful at it. And let me tell you why, and here's my statement why conversion therapy doesn't exist. Any former LGBTQ person that I know has never experienced conversion therapy. I have a network of 70 nations of leaders around the globe that no one has ever experienced conversion therapy. And if conversion therapy existed in the United States, where is the lawsuit? There isn't one. Where's the medical malpractice? If these things that are claimed were done to people, where's the medical malpractice lawsuit? Where are the people in jail? It doesn't exist. And so we need to be clear that this narrative that they've developed globally to ban counseling is actually harming people. And I'll tell you why. People, specifically men, have double the rate of suicide, double the rate of depression, anxiety, because they're trying to live a lie that they're gay, and that's not the truth. You're not born this way, and it's not genetic. And so what counseling did is it laid a foundation for me to understand. It had to deal with my connection with my father or lack thereof. And for whatever reason, I didn't bond with my dad. And when those needs aren't met, when you hit puberty, they become sexualized. Every little boy needs to connect with his father, a male role model, if you don't have a father. And when that doesn't happen, it's the possibility of those needs becoming sexualized when you hit puberty. And that's what I'll say my experience has been. And as I've dealt with men and women dealing with LGBTQ issues, a lot of them, women, it's more emotional, men, it's more physical. But this played out for me in my life. I wasn't good at sports. Now, granted, I did Ironman, but that didn't involve balls. I wasn't coordinated. I didn't do well. My brother was. Yeah, I know. I know. It's like, I.
The ball back and forth, that was beyond your
Yeah.
masculine
But my book
capability.
talk, yeah, my book tells a great story about how, as a grown man, a buddy of mine in my men's group helped teach me how to do that. I was afraid of the ball. So he goes, let's go meet on the ball field. And I did. And I brought my mitt and ball and a bat. And he goes, okay, we're going to play catch and you're not going to use the mitt. I was, okay. So we just caught the ball with our hands. Then he goes, I'm going to throw the ball and hit you in the chest. I'm like, what? And he goes, okay, just trust me. I said, okay. So he threw the ball and I didn't catch it, hit me in the chest. He goes, did that hurt? No. He said, okay, now pick up the mitt and take the mitt and protect yourself. Don't use it, but don't let the ball hit. So I batted the ball away with the mitt. He said, now catch the ball with the mitt. What he did as a grown man, as two grown men, he taught me to get over my fear of being hit with the ball. And guess what? I used the glove and I caught the ball and I didn't get hit. Something as rudimentary as going back and revisiting something that no one really took the time to work with me as a child. He did as an adult. And guess what? I started playing softball and I was the men's pastor and started playing softball in our men's softball league. And I had a blast. But again, somebody took the time to work with me to get over these childhood fears, not to be afraid of the ball. And then that might seem simple, but it's that same concept of kind of going back and revisiting and overcoming these things so I could be a healthier person. And now my kids are playing soccer. I was terrible at soccer. Now it's cut. Now, granted, my kids are 5, 7, and 10. But now I'm like, wow, my soccer skills aren't as bad as I thought they were, as I'm teaching them how to kick with their left, their right foot, and being a dad with them. It's kind of I'll say retaught me how to play soccer well and not be afraid of the ball.
So let's go back and pick up a couple of these threads that you've laid down for us, okay? So the first thing I want to call out or call attention to is just this term conversion therapy. I'm grateful that for what you said, for the testimony that you gave there, because the misuse of language is something that has been driving us all crazy for a long time. And so it's important not to use the terminology that has been invented for us, because the terminology has the ideology baked into it.
Correct.
Okay, and so the sleight of hand here, and you correct me if I'm not capturing your thought processor, but the sleight of hand here is to label any kind of therapeutic intervention as the equivalent of being tortured in the woods by some ignorant Bible-thumping pastor. I mean,
Correct.
that's what has been created. And I'll just mention, we at the Ruth Institute have a number of videos on this topic, including one where we have a forensic psychologist dissecting Sam Brinton's so-called testimony, which is false. I mean, the guy enjoys lying. You know, it's basically the result of her analysis of him.
Sure.
So when you say no one's experienced conversion therapy, that's what you mean. But many people have experienced some kind of counseling with the hope or the thought or maybe the side effect of somehow addressing same-sex attraction and the problems that it may be causing in people's lives.
Yeah,
Is that a fair summary?
Yes, counsel, and it's called counseling choice, which is what I would say in any healthy therapeutic relationship, whatever your issue or issues might be, the client determines the path in which they want to go, not the therapist. And what's happened is through legislation in some states and in countries, counselors are prohibited to come alongside and help a child and adult choose the direction they want to go. And so what we're saying is, look, or what I'm saying is, if you want to be gay and that's what you want to do, you know what? God gives us choice. You can choose to do that. But let me tell you, you will destroy your body, your psyche, and your mind, amongst other things. And it is not healthy. It is not normal. And now in the whole trans movement, okay, transgender male, transgender female people are seriously have a serious mental health illness. And you know what? If you don't address the mental health issue, you're going to destroy a person's body, literally. Not only psychologically, but now that we're doing this with chemically and physical mutilations where people's
Right.
bodies, and you cannot undo what is happening to children, let alone an adult. But at 18, if you want to destroy your body, that God has given you that choice. He loves us so much. He lets us choose what we, him or not him. And it breaks my heart because now you're dealing with a severe mental health issue that's being ignored and allowing
Yes.
someone to literally to destroy themselves.
We've interviewed a number of detransitioners and therapists, and this is the story that comes back again and again. It's not just the harm done by the attempt to transition. It's also the ignoring of other problems that really need to be addressed, and if they don't get addressed, they get swept under the rug, and then they have all kind of manifestations and stuff. I do want to go back though to your personal story, if you don't mind. Give us just a little timeline. When did you start experiencing same-sex attraction? How old were you when you started acting on it? Give us a little bit of the story of how you walked away from that.
Yeah, so in seventh grade, I started realizing I was attracted to men. And I didn't know why, but it was a sexual attraction. And so I kind of wrestled with it. I mean, I was reading God's word. I was looking in the Bible, the passages that discussed homosexuality. I knew it was a sin. I knew it was wrong, but didn't know why after reading scripture and praying and asking God to take these desires away, why they weren't leaving. And I finally got the courage to share at a church camp with my youth pastor and met with him once on the topic and kind of moved on. You know, I was a solid, came from a solid family. Every family is dysfunctional, Jenny. Mine was more on the functioning side of things. My dad was an LA County sheriff, my mom a librarian. But again, those desires weren't going away, even though I was praying, I had shared with someone. And then as a sophomore in high school, I told a buddy I was having a difficult time and still attracted to men. He goes, I think you need to tell our youth pastor. He met with me and then said, look, you need to share this with your parents. And I would recommend not only sharing with your parents, if you don't, I will tell your parents. And I said, that's okay, Pastor Doug. I will talk to my parents. You don't have to tell them, which was really wise of him to do. And then the follow-up meeting, he did end up meeting with my folks and recommended a counselor that a therapist that laid, and this is in California. As a young man at 16, I started going to counseling. But let me tell you what happened. And I didn't realize this until I wrote a book on my story. When I told my parents I was struggling with same-sex attraction, my dad broke down and wept. And I've
Oh.
never seen my dad cry. I mean, he was
Oh.
a drill instructor at the Sheriff's Academy, and deputies couldn't believe my dad had children because he was so mean as a drill instructor. But yet, I'd never seen my dad cry. And I didn't learn this until I wrote the book. And I'm like, kind of like, Dad, why didn't you tell me this back then? It really would have been helpful. But Jenny, you know why he told me he was crying? He said, my son was all alone battling with something and had no one to come alongside of him. That's why my dad
Wow.
broke down crying.
Wow.
And
Wow.
it so warmed my heart. Again, like I wish I would have known that at the age of 16, but in my 40s, I think I wrote, yeah, I was still in my 40s when I wrote my book. to learn that with healing and understanding and just a better understanding the heart of my dad.
So when you say he broke down and cried, he didn't do that in front of you. That you found out way after the fact that that
Correct.
has had been his.
Yes.
I see. I
When
see.
I wrote
Okay.
the book,
So
he revealed that to me, and I go, Dad, that
I
was
see.
really just understanding your heart was so helpful. So that was at age 16. Counseling laid this great foundation of understanding of same-sex attraction. But then at the age of 23, I was accused of being gay. I was living in the island of Bermuda, and homosexuality was illegal. I was a virgin at the time, but I got fired and accused of being gay. Now, I'd never done a homosexual act, came back to the United States devastated, and I ended up moving to Portland, Oregon, came out, and just kind of said, look, God, if I'm going to be, accused of this and, I want to love and be loved, your plan isn't going to work for me if I'm attracted to men. So I came out in Portland, Oregon in 1999.
If I got the name, I'm going to play the game, is basically
Exactly.
what you decided. So there you were 23 in
Yeah, I was
Portland,
23 years
Oregon,
old.
living on your own, not your family's not around you and stuff like that. And so what was that like for you? What happened
Oh, it was a blast. I loved it. It was fun. You're with this
then?
community that's saying we'll welcome you. And I tell you, I really learned a lot because the LGBTQ community is very loving, opening, and welcoming to anybody. The weirdos, the freaks, the geeks, the people with, just people that don't fit into culture. You have a community that says, welcome, we love you. It's in its family. They call it you kind of your gay family. And moving into an environment like that, and Jenny, sin is fun. I mean, that's why it's so alluring. It's fun. It's a blast. I know.
What? You're the first person who's ever said that. That's right. It's the superficial appeal, especially at the
Absolutely.
beginning, and then it kind of unwinds.
It's like what you see on TV. Everything's perfect. It's fun. There's no drama. There's no pain. There's no consequences. And then reality starts hitting in. And I was so broken. I did not care my partner was HIV positive and hepatitis C positive. Now, hep C is a lot more contagious than HIV. And praise God, thank God that he protected me from those and other diseases. It's really a miracle. On the path in which I was living, and yet God protected me from those diseases. I all I can say it was his grace and mercy, because I know a lot of friends of mine who've come out of the lifestyle and are HIV positive and are dealing with those diseases.
So how long were you, did you have a permanent partner the whole time that you were
So
gay?
I was in the lifestyle for 5 years, 23 to 28 in my 20s. My partner and I were together for three. And I kind of the devil's really good at, just partial part truths, little just twist it a little bit. And I thought, well, if I applied God's principles of marriage to my partner, and as Christians live, this is gonna work. And it's not. And my partner was an alcoholic, addicted to marijuana, and I saw this for the first time, and I just was like, this is a life of living hell. And on the outside, we were the happy couple. We owned an art gallery, we were successful, we made a lot of money, we lived like kings, and yet underneath it all is I was, you're dying inside, and the life behind closed doors is a living hell. And I'll never forget, my partner filed a restraining order with the Palm Springs Police Department, and all this drama's going on. God sent Christians.
I have to interrupt. He did what? He filed a restraining order against you?
Yes, he
What were
falsified a
you doing?
document. He said I
What
was
were you
violent.
doing?
Well, he said I was
Ooh.
violent. I own guns, heaven forbid, Second Amendment. And he said that I was going to use them against him. Well, so they went ahead and they filed a temporary restraining order. The order was actually thrown out and expunged because it was all falsified. I've never hit another person in my life. I mean, I'm more of a pacifist than anything. I've never struck another human being, and out of anger or anything like that. But anybody can file a false report And with restraining orders, you're guilty until you're proven innocent, which is, I understand the reasoning why, but now I had to go and prove, which again, it was thrown out and expunged because it was all falsified. But
And if I may say, since you just said that, I
yeah.
want to chime in that a lot of people who've been through divorce or other forms of family breakdown, restraining orders are a part of their lives. And people making false accusations is now very much a part of the drama surrounding family breakdown and so on. And I have never heard of anyone being penalized for perjury in a family court. It may have happened somewhere, but I've heard people call it liar's court because people just say stuff and, you know, it's hard to prove and disprove in that environment. And so it just, it's really a, it's a big problem throughout, not just the gay, not just on the gay community side. I mean, it's just a big problem. Anyway,
I was
continue with your
28
story,
at the time,
Jimmy.
but that is really insightful, Jenny. And you know what? To have countersued for perjury, again, you know, so no one's held accountable. You know what I mean? You can just make these
That's the
claims and
point.
then, well, you're in a situation. But God sent Christian police officers. I didn't know this at the time. But actually, one of the police, now, you know, get this. The police officer that actually served me the restraining order, she was in my wedding. How many cops become friends with the people they serve restraining orders to? I mean, that doesn't happen. But that just tells you how God was not only moving and working, but then, you know, we're having this conversation. I said, yeah, I knew what I was doing was wrong, meaning living in a gay lifestyle. I said, God does not call this. I'm telling this to the police officer. And she's looking at me like there's something different about you. And I just started sharing with her what Jesus had done and the miracles he had started doing in my life when this whole, all this drama was unfolding.
So part of your part of the story of your relationship, well, part of your journey is the fact that this relationship broke up and the way in which it broke up revealed certain things to you. That's what I'm hearing. Is
Yes, it
that
did.
right? Because
It
you
did.
thought it was good for a long time. It was good, right? You said your opening line was it was a blast.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, and then not, and then. The next whole sequence started, and this cop, this female Christian cop who showed up to, with the restraining order, she's part of the story. What happened then? Was it the breakup with your partner that led to you leaving the lifestyle altogether, or were there other steps as well?
Well, let me throw this about what the cop told me, and this has always stuck with me. Palm Springs has a high LGBTQ population. She said the worst domestics, 415 says police language, which is a domestic violence. She said the worst are lesbian couples and homosexual couples. And I that just kind of threw me for a loop, and I'm like, no kidding. This is just what they get called to, what they see behind the scenes that nobody else gets to see. She goes, these are the worst domestics. And I was, because this is not what God intended. Anyway, it kind of makes sense. But all that to say, my partner had switched all of our bank account information, everything overnight. So he took all the funds out of our accounts, put it into an account exclusively with his name on it, files a restraining order, and literally overnight, I went from everything to nothing. And I had some gay friends that said, Jim, you can come live in one of our apartments. We own the apartment building across the street from your gallery. You can stay there for a month, but you're going to have to come up with a deposit and rent after that 30-day period. You can't live here rent-free. And I was broken. I had no money, no nothing. And that first night, I laid in Palm Springs, California, June 8th, 2002. And it's hot in June in Palm Springs, like over 100, no air conditioning. And I laid on the floor of an apartment building, only the clothes on my back. And I looked up the ceiling. I said, God, I'm yours again. And I don't know why I prayed that prayer, but when you have nowhere else to go, I gave my life back to the Lord. And that next morning, I got up and I'm like, well, I don't think he canceled my gym membership. I'm going to go to Gold's and work out. And on my way to the car on a public street in North Palm Springs, on right next to Highway 111, there was a $5 bill laying on the sidewalk next to my car. And when I picked up that bill, the Lord said, Jim, I took care of the Israelites in the desert, and I'll take care of you and yours.
Wow.
And Jenny, where do you go if you only have $5 for breakfast?
Salvation Army.
No, well, close. Yeah, that would be free because you can go into a rehab program. But I went to Denny's. They had a $2.99 Grand Slam breakfast. So I could
There you
get
go.
breakfast and enough money after tax for a little tip. And I actually told the black manager there in North Palm Springs. He probably thought I was one of these crazy people, but I'm like, I got to tell you what God just did. I broke up with my partner. He provided this meal, and I can't believe what Jesus is doing in my life. And he's kind of like, all right, get out of here. But that day was pivotal to me because I actually had some friends call me, or I called my friends that actually would visit me when I was in the lifestyle. And I kind of said, hey, I more or less told them, you better start praying for me. Although I'm still gay, keep praying for me because God is doing something in my life.
And so somehow you made the next step. We at that point, were you committed to not acting as a gay man anymore, or was that part of your thought process?
There
Where
was
how
a
did that all fit
battle.
together?
There was a battle for my soul. And that was going on. I still wanted to be gay. One of my best friends called me and said, Jim, why don't you come back to the farm and help come to the farm? And I flew to Pennsylvania. They bought me a ticket. I flew to Pennsylvania and I did hay. I baled hay. I stacked hay. We chopped wood. We did manly things on the farm. And God just began to heal and restore me. I hadn't stepped inside of a church in 3 years or something like that, or 5 years. Went to a little podunk Moreland Baptist Church somewhere. I think it's in Moreland, Pennsylvania, a little country church. And God just began to heal, restore, and just reading His word just started washing me clean. And when I flew back to Palm Springs to my apartment, my buddy's like, hey, you got to come up with rent. And I'm like, I don't have any money. And my parents were saying, Jim, move back home. And I'm like, I don't want to move. I'm 28. I've traveled the world. I've had my own home, my own business. I'm not going to move home with mommy and daddy. But as the Lord would have it, that He opened that doorway. And what began was a healing of the father-son relationship with my dad at the age of 28. And my dad, I tell you, I love my parents because it helps me better understand the grace, mercy, and faithfulness of God. When my dad said, I don't have a fatted calf to kill, but let's go to one of the best restaurants in Orange County. We want to take, and you can get veal, you can get, filet mignon, lobster, whatever you want. We are going to celebrate my son has returned home. And we did.
Wow, that's so beautiful, Jim. That's really a beautiful story. And I'm glad you told that, because we have a lot of people who watch this program who are the parents in your story, okay? And they're wondering what to do for their child and how to help and how to not do anything stupid, and I numerous people that I've interviewed have told some kind of story about how their parents never gave up on them.
Amen.
And so I want to say that to
Amen.
all of you Ruthies who are watching here, don't give up on your wayward children, okay? They need you, and you may not be able to rescue your child. You may not be able to, yeah, you may
Yes.
not, you don't know the effects of your prayer for your child. You may be helping somebody else's child. You may be the person along the way of somebody else's path. So, take heart, Ruthies. This is a very important part of your
Let me
message here,
chime
Jim.
in on that. Moms and dads, don't give up on your kids. My parents didn't. They had very strict boundaries, which I would encourage you keep those strict boundaries. But even my sister-in-law, she prayed and fasted and interceded on my behalf. And thank God I was only in the lifestyle for 5 years. And parents, I don't know the time frame when God will answer your prayers. What I can encourage you, all you Ruthies, is that He is faithful. And I do know people who've come back to the Lord after their parents have been promoted to glory, have gone to heaven, and that they won't know until that day comes, but that their child has returned back to God. And so I want to encourage you, don't give up on your kids, and don't capitulate to what their demands. You keep with scripture and God's truth, because when that day comes, I hear more stories of that. And this is not to say kids can't come back, but the parents that don't give up in that regard, though, I hear many of those stories of those children coming back to faith, coming back to God, coming back to their senses.
And coming back to their family, you know,
Yes.
that they're restored to the family.
Amen.
Jim, I really want to get into talking about the various ministries that you've been involved in. But what we're going to do now is take a short break because we bring our people over to our Locals channel where we talk about the things that are most likely to get us censored by YouTube. Hopefully, Jim's allowed to tell his story without the censors intervening. We will, I'm certain, within 30 seconds of this video being posted, there will be a nasty label from the Trevor Project explaining how conversion therapy is dangerous and discredited. But as
Yeah.
you can see, Pastor Jim is of sound mind here. He seems to be okay. He's not suicidal or anything like that. And so we'll go over to our Locals channel because what I want to ask you about next, Jim, I want to hear about your ministries. I want to hear about some of the different ways in which the combination of faith and reason have helped to restore so many people through your efforts. So, Ruthies, don't go away. Join us in just a couple minutes. We'll be right over there.